Oh, look, I have that background. I have the feature background.
Can you see us, Paul?
No, nope, it's two people.
Karen, I'm looking back at you. Your screen, you got it.
I'm in the view.
Then you might not hear.
You have a back, you have a background. And I guess you should, you can't be muted, they don't have to listen.
No, they don't. It's still two people.
I can't believe you can see that.
I need to undo that.
All right, we're gonna wait just another minute for anybody who's gonna log on either by Zoom or Facebook Live stream.
Are you at the beach?
Yes, please. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation.
Amen.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin, trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God,
you search us and know us.
You are acquainted with all our ways.
We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin, our own sins, and the broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust those who are not like us. We exploit the earth and its resources, and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone. Even before the words are on our tongues, you know them. Receive them in your divine mercy. Amen.
How vast is God's grace! Through the power and promise of Jesus Christ, our sins are washed away, and we are claimed as God's own beloved. Indeed, we are forgiven. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community, living out Christ's justice and the Spirit's reconciling peace.
Amen.
First reading is from Jonah chapter 3, verses 1 through 5 and 10. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim it to the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk. And then he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. Here ends the reading. We will now read together Psalm 62. For God alone I wait in silence. Truly my hope is in God.
God alone is my rock and my salvation, my stronghold, so that I shall never be shaken.
In God is my deliverance and my honor. God is my strong rock and my refuge.
Put your trust in God always, O people. Pour out your hearts before the one who is our refuge.
Those of high degree are but a fleeting breath. Those of low estate cannot be trusted. Placed on the scales together, they weigh even less than a breath.
Put no trust in extortion. In robbery, take no empty pride. Your wealth increase, set not your heart upon it.
God has spoken once, twice have I heard it, that power belongs to God.
Steadfast love belongs to you, O Lord. For you repay all according to their deeds.
The second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 7, beginning at verse 29. Brothers and sisters, the appointed time has grown short. From now on, let even those who have wives be as though they had none, and those who mourn as though they were not mourning, and those who rejoice as though they were not rejoicing. And those who buy as though they had no possessions, and those who deal with the world as though they had no dealings with it. For the present form of this world is passing away. Here ends the reading.
Well, maybe by the end of the service, we'll have all our sound worked out. We've got a new wrinkle this Sunday. Let us continue with prayer. Gracious God, we give you thanks that you bless us every day, every moment of our lives. Bless us now with your presence in this digital worship space. That we may know your spirit, that we may know your presence, that we may know your love through your word. May the thoughts and meditations of our hearts and minds be acceptable to you. Amen. So here we have the Gospel of Mark's account of Jesus calling his disciples, or at least some of them. And it is a brief passage. I read this, and basically Jesus is walking along, according to Mark, and Jesus says, follow me. And we've got Simon and his brother Andrew. We got James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. And they all just stop what they're doing. James and his brother John are in their fishing boat, mending their nets with their father Zebedee, and they just drop what they're doing, and they just follow Jesus. Every time I read this, I can't help but have an initial knee-jerk of reaction of, really? Really? Jesus walks by and says, follow me. According to the account of Mark, for all we know, a complete perfect stranger just walks by and says, follow me, and they just drop what they're doing and they follow him. Really? Who does that? So that's my knee-jerk reaction. I've always had that. I still do when I read this account. Really? And then right after, on top of that, there's like almost envy. Almost envy. I mean, how many times have we, in my life, have thought about something, have had a desire to do it, and didn't? And they did. Boy, I really like to go to the shore this year. There's been many summers over the years where I've thought that to myself and never did it. And then, just the past couple years, I've had moments where I've thought, hey, want to go to the shore this year? Well, why not? And just did it. Well, as direct and as simple as the Gospel of Mark portrays Jesus calling his disciples, we know by looking at the other accounts of Jesus calling his disciples that it's a bit more involved. The other Gospels develop the narrative further, especially those synoptic Gospels, similar Gospels to Mark repeat a lot of the same stories, the Gospel of Luke and the Gospel of Matthew. In those Gospels, we had the added character of Peter. They've come back, they've been mending their nets, it's morning, they've been out all night fishing, they're tired. Jesus comes along and says, hey, let's go back out again. And they go out, they're tired, Peter's grumbling, and they put the nets over the side of the boat just to entertain this guy named Jesus. And the nets fill with fish, and they pull it overboard, and it almost swamps the boat. And Jesus tells them, I will make you fisher of men. And they follow him. Yeah, a lot of ways, Mark is kind of like the montage gospel. It just speeds through just one thing after another, abbreviated compared to the other gospels. Jesus is always in a hurry. Almost every transition, you have the word immediately. And immediately Jesus went here, and immediately Jesus did this. Mark does take a little more time developing the call narrative when he calls Levi the tax collector. The next chapter after this. A lot of the primary 12 and all the Gospels, we don't hear all their call stories. But back to that reaction. Really? What was going on there? What is it to follow? To hear God's call? And to follow. And that's what I really want to get into. This notion of discerning God's call and following. And that's a special word, discerning, to discern, discernment. It's different than decision making. Decision making, the classic decision making process, is that you look at what the decision is to do this. You kind of pinpoint, you define the decision, and then you weigh the pros and the cons, and you make a logical, weighing inside your head as to whether or not I should do this. And you decide, and then you do. Discernment is bigger than that. Decision-making can be part of discernment. But discernment is to discern something, is to look beyond yourself and acknowledge something. I discern that there are pews in this sanctuary where I stand. You and where you are may discern a chair upon which you sit. I assume everybody's sitting on a chair or a couch or something. The walls around you, a discernment is to take in and to weigh and to define. I discern that it's cold out this morning and I can feel a chill. And with careful discernment, there are themes to discernment that happen throughout Scripture. You can look at these themes. It would require a multi-week Bible study to really unpack all these different elements of discernment. And maybe that's something we can do. I'm not going to do that here in a sermon. But you can go and you can look at the call story of Moses. You can look at the call story of Abraham. You can look at the call story of Jeremiah. You can look at the call story of Paul the Apostle. And you can see these various elements if you look for them. So when you do discernment as to what God is or where God is calling you, unlike a decision-making process where you define the choice, discernment at its purest is not even giving, it's before you even have recognition of what your choices are. It's looking around to see what your choices are, to see where God is calling you. And there's usually a push and a pull to discernment. So the push comes from where you're at. With this push, there is usually a need for change. There's usually some type of death, some type of sin, some type of human frailty, some type of the circumstances are shifting. And the way that things were aren't going to be that way for one reason or another. That there's a need, that there is a as Scripture will reference childbirth, that the pangs will come upon. There are signs in the moment that are upon you, and to discern those. With the push, there's also this other side of it. That is prepared. That when you weigh the push with the other side of it, the push and the pull, you can recognize ways and where you're at is preparing you. Somehow there have been things in your life, either where you're at now or where you've been in the past, that prepare you for the pull. That the push and the pull are connected. They're related to each other. And the pull. That's the possibility. And the pull both excites and terrifies, usually. If it's all good, if it's all possibility, that's the one part. If it's all possibility, all wonderful, and there's no fear of what change that may entail, often that might be too good to be true. Or maybe we're perceiving something, we're wishfully perceiving more promise and something that's safer than what God normally would call us towards. Usually when God calls us towards something, it challenges us. That there is change. that in response to that need for change or inevitable change that's about to come, God promises, yes, there'll be change, that I will change you, that I will pull you here. You will start this journey to a new place, and when you get there, you will not be the same person. That I will build upon you. I will build upon you in all those ways I've been preparing you, and this push, the pull, will bring that to fruit, to bear. So there's the push and the pull. And with the pull, if it's all excitement, it's all positive, maybe, you know, it's not the real change we really need. And the other side of that, if it's totally terrifying, and there's nothing there, there's no promise to excite you, to look forward to, well, then maybe that's not of God as well. That it's in between those, that excited and terrified. It's a mix of the two. So there's the push. There's the push and there's the pull. And then there's that moment. The moment that we do see captured in the Gospel of Mark. In our story, which my knee-jerk reaction is, really? They just dropped what they were doing? The Gospel doesn't tell us what the push and the pull was. Maybe they were just barely making a living as fishermen, and that was part of the push. Maybe they had always had a deep interest in their faith, and they had heard of this Jesus wandering, who was going to be passing by, and they were already wondering about the possibility, and there was a pull there. Maybe it was just the way Jesus looked at them and said those words that had the pull. The Gospel of Mark doesn't tell us what the push and the pull are, but it does capture that moment of shift. And when I picture the moment of shift when it comes to discernment, that shift from where the push and the pull moves us from where we're at to what God's calling us toward, it's like, in my head, I visualize it as climbing a tree and shifting one from one branch to the next. And as you shift from this branch to the next branch, there's a letting go of where you're at, and there's a grabbing hold of the branch that is there for you. That's what we see. As they drop their nets, we're seeing them let go of the net and grasp on to this new path of following Jesus. And yes, it does look as simple as that. And in that moment, it is quite that simple of letting go and following. But usually that moment of letting go and grabbing on, whether we're able to see it, it's kind of like plate tectonics and an earthquake. The earthquake hits suddenly, and it seems to be out of the blue, but that's the let go and grab on, the moment when it shakes, when things move. But usually it takes years, decades, even hundreds of years for the pressures to build in the crust before they're released. And that's the push and the pull. And then there's that other knee-jerk reaction I have to this text. Of course, I've got all this wonderful theology about discernment in my head, and yet I read this, and I still have those knee-jerk reactions. Really? And envy. That envy is faith. Admiration for the faith that they just let go and grabbed on and followed. my experience of when that let go and grab on moment happens. Sometimes it happens when the forces of the push and the pull are so great. We are just so emotionally moved in the moment, we let go of the branch we're on and we grab the branch that God offers us. Sometimes that branch is put before us and we just cling to the branch we're on. That the push and the pull in that moment just isn't quite enough for whatever reason. That our fears get the best of us. The fear of looking down and what if I fall? What if that branch I grab onto, what if it breaks? And we hold on tight. We all know what that feels like. And we all have regrets when we have done that and we feel like we've missed out on something. There are other times when the branch just breaks that we're on. The crisis happens. And we reach out, and the branch is there. And we catch it. I think for a lot of people, that's what happens. I think for a lot of people, when it happens enough times and the branch happens to be there, and they get cautious or they start discerning and they start seeing the branch that God might be calling us to, that this discernment, that they start to do more of it and you get better at it, you get more attuned to it. That when you've gone through enough branch breaks and grabbing on to the branch God gives you, you began to anticipate the branch being given to you, and then you're more able to not wait until the branch breaks. And do what I admire so much of the disciples that Jesus calls on our text, to just let go, to grab on, to follow in a way that makes others look at you and say, really? Here's the good news, and I got two things to offer you. The first thing is this. So when you take time to pray, when you take time to reflect on life, when you take time to put the pause button, all those things that tell us they are so important, that would distract us from the branches around us that God calls us to grab onto, to climb to a better existence. We put a pause button on those things to process what's around us, to discern the world around us, to look for God's activity in the ways that God is calling us. Life becomes vibrant. We go from just tunnel vision, looking at those things that tell us they're so much more important than everything else. Martin Luther would say, stop the belly button gazing and pull our heads up and look around us. Life goes from being in black and white to HD 4K vivid color. The good news is that with discernment, it allows us to not only let go and grab on in the direction God calls us, it allows us to enjoy the life that we have in this moment and appreciate the blessings we have in this moment, to see how we're constantly being sustained so that we have even greater faith, to let go and grab on knowing it will be okay. And here's even better news than that. What about those moments when we look at that branch that is there that we're feeling called to grab on to. And we're paralyzed by our fear. And the opportunity passes away. What about those moments? Here's the really good news. We're not called just once. Like a parent calling for their child who's lost, or a lover yearning for the one who means so much to them and calls again and again, God doesn't just call us once, but again and again, yearning for us to reach for the blessings, the opportunities, the changes, the resurrections that we need in our life over and over again. The good news is God never gives up on us and always has a better plan for us, because God loves us so much. Amen.
Seek of the sea.
Let us profess the Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us share the peace with one another. Peace, everybody. Peace, Zoom folks. Peace. Ah. And now the prayers of intercession.
Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. For the church throughout the world, for pastors and teachers, for deacons and deaconesses, and for musicians and servers, that all proclaim the good news of God's reconciling love, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For skies and seas, for birds and fish, for favorable weather and clean water, and for the well-being of creation, that God raise up advocates and scientists to guide our care for all the earth, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For those who provide leadership in our cities and around the world, for nonprofit and non-governmental organizations, for planning commissions and homeless advocates, that God inspire all people in the just use of wealth, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For those who are sick, distressed, or grieving, for the outcast and all who wait relief, that in the midst of suffering, God's peace and mercy surround them, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For our congregation and community, for families big and small, and for the organizations that meet here during the week, that God's steadfast love serve as a model for all relationships, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
If you have any needs for prayer, you can either mention them out loud or you can mention them in your heart. In thanksgiving for our ancestors in the faith, whose lives serve as an example of gospel living, that they point us to salvation through Christ, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen. Let us now pray as our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, teaches us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now the blessing. God, the Creator, strengthen you. Jesus, the Beloved, fill you. And the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, keep you in peace.
Amen.
Amen. Our final hymn that we are going to sing is not what is printed in the liturgy. So you are welcome, those of you on Zoom and tuning in by YouTube video and Facebook live stream are welcome to listen along. Thank you. now the dismissal. Go in peace, be the light of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you to our worship team for you being here. Good to see you folks on Zoom. Hope you all have a good week. And those of you on Facebook live stream, you have a good week as well. I look forward to seeing you all next week. Same time, same place.